Hello everyone and welcome to the presentation for the smooth complexity of local max cut and binary constraint satisfaction problems for stock 2020. I am Emmanuel Vladakis and this is a joint work with Xi Chen, Michalis Yanakakis from Columbia University and Xinzi Chang and Chenghao Kuo from Tsinghua University. Let's start our discussion with a fundamental and always motivating question. When actually an algorithm should be considered efficient? One of the most famous examples where practice and theory are not consistent in the answer of this question is local search methods. Despite their wide success in practice, many local search algorithms, like k-means and simplex, under the worst-case framework are considered inefficient. In fact, many proofs of bad worst-case complexity tend to use constructions which are very unnatural in any real-life setting. Typically, our alternative is average case analysis. Unfortunately, this is a very optimistic choice. While it avoids unnatural instances, it may focus because of the choice of the distribution of the model in totally unstructured instances. In order to bridge these problems, the smooth analysis framework has been introduced by Spielman and Teng in 2001 to provide at least some rigorous justification for this observed good practical performance of those algorithms, but more importantly, without fully destroying the internal structure of an instance. In this talk, we will discuss about another interesting case of this story, the case of the local max cut problem, where we want to find a partition of the vertices of a weighted undirected graph, such that the weight of the cut cannot be improved locally by just moving one of the nodes to the other side. For our analysis, we will use the most obvious single flip algorithm family. We start from an initial configuration of the vertices, and as long as we can find some vertices whose single flip to the other side would increase the weight of the cut, we select one of them and we flip it. So let's try now to specialize the smooth analysis framework to our problem. First of all, it is worthy to mention that we can always normalize the weights to -1, 1, since the combinatorial structure of the problem does not change at all. So in this model, given an arbitrary graph, we just sample the weights of the edges from a distribution that has bounded density. Let's call this bound phi. First of all, notice that we respect fully the structure of the graph. We don't add any new edges at all. Secondly, notice that the special case of this model is when the adversary picks arbitrary weights, which then are perturbed by adding a small random noise, where here phi is something like the inverse of the variance of the noise. Finally, while phi goes to infinity, we allow very concentrated distributions close to the worst case analysis. The other edge case of 1/2 corresponds to the uniform distribution and the average case. The complexity question now in this work is to bound the maximum expected number of steps of the flip algorithm in terms of the size of the graph and the parameter phi under this perturbation model. It is worthy to mention that last 10 years, there was an extensive research on the smooth complexity of local max cut. We summarize the previous work with the following 2 points. We know that flip algorithm runs in smooth polynomial time for special kind of graphs, like complete graphs or graphs with bounded degree. On the other hand, the best previous result for the general case was the quasi-polynomial n to log n of Hedgehill and Rogling. This is actually the major open question. What is the smooth time complexity of local max cut for flip algorithm for arbitrary graphs? Can we close the gap and prove the conjecture that the smooth complexity is totally polynomial? Our main result improved the state-of-art complexity bound to n to square root of log n steps. Here we have 2 results. Theorem 1 states the high probability argument, that flip terminates with high probability at most in n to square root of log n steps. This is actually a weaker model, the probabilistic analysis model. However, by just controlling the tails of the failure of the analysis, we can strengthen the result on expectation to the actual smooth analysis model. In this talk, we will concentrate our discussion for simplicity to the high probability statement. Finally, we saw that our smooth analysis framework is applicable not only to local max cut, which includes actually parity constraints, but to the general case of all the binary constraint satisfaction problems. Thus, our result provides similar complexity guarantees for problems like local max to sat, stable neural net, or local network affiliation gain. Now, let's start our analysis with a fundamental question. What is actually the contribution of a flip? The improvement of a flip is the sum of the edges that we earn minus the sum of the edges that we lose because of a flip. Also notice that since the weights are bounded by 1, the maximum possible cut is at most n squared. Thus, if we could show that in every block of L steps, for example, there was at least one large improvement, let's say at least epsilon, something inverse polynomial, for example, then the algorithm would run at most n squared times L over epsilon steps. Where if epsilon was inverse polynomial and L was something like linear, that corresponds to a smooth polynomial running time. So the real question here is, how much unlikely could we be? What is the probability of existence of a block that contains only very small improvements? If that probability was small, then we were done. Let's start with a simple case, the case of just one flip. The probability to give very small improvement, let's say at most epsilon, is simple, since the improvement from flipping a node is just minus plus sum of some random variables with bounded density. It is not difficult to see that this probability is at most order of epsilon. Now, in the wonderland, if all the flips were independent events, then the probability of a bad block is just the product of the separated bad flips. Thus, it is dropping exponentially, as you can see, to n. Notice again that we have to union bound also over all the initial configurations and the possible linear blocks. Back to real world now. In a graph where flips are too correlated by the structure of the graph, you cannot expect that this independence holds globally. However, if we write down the linear forms of the improvements of every flip of the block, our intuition was partially correct. It is dropping exponentially to the number of the linear independent flips, which we will call the rank of the block. Thus, the ultimate question here is, how many linear independent forms can we have? How many independent flips can happen in any linear length block? Unfortunately, we know cases where at least one of the linear blocks has small rank. Thus, the union bound 2 to the n is a serious obstacle in order to bound this catastrophic event. To tackle now this problem, Mitchell and Roglin proposed the idea of analyzing the improving arcs. So instead of one flip of a node, we will analyze two consecutive flips of the same node in a block. More formally, we will call arc a pair of moments, I, j, such that in the ith and in the jth move, we flip the same node, but in the middle period, this node will not be flipped at all. In other words, an arc corresponds actually to the fourth and back of a node. To understand better this tool, let's give an example. Let's focus in the red node. In the plot, in the ith move, we flip the red node and we earn edge A1 with the pink node. In the meantime, the pink node flips many, but odd times, let's say, and the black nodes flip even times. But we have no extra jump for the red node. In the jth move, we flip back the red node, earning again E1, closing the arc I, j of the red node. Now, what was the real benefit of this tool? The illustrative example notified an important property. In arcs, in comparison with flips, we care only about the vertices that flip at some point inside the period of the arc. From so on, we will call them the active neighbors of the node of that arc. From all those active nodes, we care actually only about those who moved odd times during the arc period. Now, to illustrate better this observation, we say that the gain of the arc is just the sum of the flips of the red node. Notice that E1, the survived edge, was the edge of the odd times moved neighbor. On the other hand, the edges from the vertices which didn't move at all or even times appear always with opposite sign in the expressions, so in the final expression they will be cancelled. Of course, again, we have a linear form, so we have the same issue with the linear independent improvements of the arcs this time. However, with the usage of that tool, Roegling and Ed Child showed that for a long sequence, there is always a very special substring whose the percentage of the independent arcs actually is at least 1 over log n. This is the way that we should interpret that result. More importantly, check that the actual union bound in the expression is now 2 to the L instead of 2 to the N, since we have to condition only about the different configuration of the active nodes. Notice that by rephrasing the lemma, we don't care now about the absolute number of the linear independent arcs, we don't care about the absolute number of the rank, but for the ratio of the length of the block and the rank of the arcs of that block. Thus, if the ratio between the rank and the length was constant, for example, in other words, if the 80% of the arcs have linear independent forms in their improvements, then flip algorithm would run in smooth polynomial time. Unfortunately, in ABPPW17 and in our work, we present a history of moves and graphs where this ratio for consecutive block is tight. So we need surely new ideas to go further. Having said all this, we are now ready to dig deeper inside the problem of the relative ratio of the rank and the length of the block. If someone would like to summarize our technique with two concepts, then we can say the following. In this work, we present the idea of removing moves from the analysis of the progress of an algorithm without violating the correctness of the analysis. More specifically, we present how someone can drop irrelevant flips and thus decreasing the denominator of the ratio. On the other hand, if we fail to do that, we show that this case is never against us, so we can always find even larger families of arcs which are independent. Our main technical lemma says that if you give me an enough large sequence, then there is a subsequence B such that the density, the ratio of the rank and the length of the subsequence is 1 over square root of log n, which implies that flip would run in n to square root of log n steps for arbitrary graph. Again, let's emphasize in the phrase lossless subsequence B instead of a consecutive subblock, since now we can delete nodes, but we emphasize that we will not violate the correctness of the analysis. Due to the restriction of the time, we will focus actually only in the deletion process, which is actually the pretty novel part in the smooth analysis framework generally. However, since the two concepts are interconnected, we will explore some of the machinery of the other case too. Before starting, let's motivate further the idea of deleting moves. Now imagine a long arc with a node in the interior that flips 20 times. For the analysis of this long arc, at the end of this back and forth, this pinny picky over flipping node, even if it was neighbor of the node of that arc, would be in its original position. So it would be something like unmoved. The same issue holds for a neighbor that flips 51 times. It's just like that it is flipped once. Thus, it seems that what really matters is the parity of the occurrences. Unfortunately, it is not so easy to delete all the even occurrences of all nodes in the analysis. Here is an important takeaway. If we want to delete flips from the block, the arcs of our analysis should preserve their linear forms of their improvements. Otherwise, we cheat. Otherwise, we discuss about a different semantically execution of the flip. Let's see an illustrative example. Let alpha 1 and alpha 2 be the two red arcs of the same node. Also notice that alpha 1 overlaps with beta 1 from the right side and alpha 2 overlaps with beta 2 from the left side. Additionally, beta 1 and beta 2 contain 3 occurrences of the red node. Assume also that the corresponding nodes are real neighbors in the actual graph. Now, the main question here is the following. Can we delete any red moves and keep the improvement linear forms of the blue arcs, beta 1 and beta 2, the same? If you try alpha 1, then beta 1 will contain now 2 red nodes, violating the parity. In other words, we are sure that we are violating the linear form of the improvement of that arc. If you try to delete alpha 2, similar issue would exist with beta 2. However, there are choices sometimes, such that the black one, where we can preserve the parity after deletion. Notice that the black one does not overlap really with beta 1 or beta 2. So the main message here is the following.
the deletions are not panacea. And since we want to delete irrelevant flips, it seems crucial to understand the fundamental case of the non-deletable move. Let's check the following important example. Now, if this node is a neighbor of the red one in the actual graph, then it cannot be deleted at all. Why? Because it appears inside the interior of the red arc once. In other words, odd times, and we assume that it is neighbor also. So it surely contributes in the linear form of the improvement of that arc. But that creates an interesting question here. What if many arcs contain such nodes, let's call them singleton nodes, then what we will do? In that case, we can use them to improve the rank by proving independence. Let's see why. In the linear form of this arc, the weight of the edge between the red and the blue node would surely appear. We discussed that. And since blue will never appear again, inside the block at least, the variable of this weight of the graph edge would be unique and would not appear anywhere else in any other linear form of this block. Thus, this variable could play the role of a witness for the arc alpha to prove that it is linear independent inside the block. That is the main machinery that we leverage for all the other interesting cases, actually. Now, what is worse than a non-deletable move? Of course, the overlapping non-deletable arcs that we saw before. Here is our approach about them. We will set a history of flips of size 5n. Thus, we have enough arcs. We can prove that they are at least 4n to 5n. Now, we partition the arcs geometrically into log n buckets based on their length. So the first bucket will contain the small arcs with length 1 to 2. The second bucket will contain the arcs with length 3 to 4. The third bucket will contain the arcs 5 to 8, and so on. So we construct log n buckets. Now, using some simple averaging argument, we can find an interesting sublock that contains an enough densely bucket with density of arcs 1 over log n, and also has the property that almost all the edges of this bucket in this sublock are full rank. Now let's describe it simply. That means that there is a block with ratio rank over length that it is 1 over log n. By the previous argumentation now, we know that that result could give at most n to log n result. So how the deletion process could help here? In our best expectation, we would like just to delete all the other nodes in this block and make the ratio of these full rank arcs constant by just keeping the nodes of these arcs. Now let's assume that in the plot, betas are the full rank arcs of the lemma. And so let's assume that the majority of the arcs in this interval overlap with these full rank arcs of the lemma. As we say before, it is combinatorially very difficult to delete them safely. But let's think a little bit practically here. Since the ratio of the full rank arcs of the lemma is 1 over log n, maybe we can sacrifice them for a larger family of arcs. For example, to use them as witness of linear independence for the bigger family of the overlapping arcs, exactly as in the case of the single non-deletable node that we saw before. And indeed, we saw that actually this is possible. If overlapping arcs have density at least 1 over square root of log n inside the block, then we can use the weights of the edges between the full rank arcs and the overlapping arcs as witnesses to prove their independence. And then we win, because we get a family of arcs which their density inside the block is at least 1 over square root of log n. And now, last but not least, we are now able to delete. Let's assume that all non-deletable flips and all overlapping arcs have a very small density. Then delete everything that you can. This is the concept of our analysis, except of course the nice full rank arcs that we have from the lemma inside the block. And the overlapping arcs that we have, we cannot delete them as we said, because they will destroy the parity invariance. But now we have the assumption that they have very small density inside the block. Also, this is the actual parameter which will decide that the final size of the new subsequence. By inspection now, this leads to the well-tailored division of those two ratios, 1 over log n over 1 over square root of log n, which gives us the 1 over square root of log n, that it is the new ratio between the rank, the number of the full rank arcs, and the new length of the subsequence. To wrap up, we sketch the way that deleting irrelevant moves from the analysis helps in the calculation of a better ratio for the independent arcs inside the sequence of flip execution. This gives us the complexity of n to square root of log n. Always in the constants, there is a hidden linear dependence with the bound of the density of the model, the fib bound. Now, we will close our discussion with some interesting open questions. First of all, is there a way to improve more this analysis, or there is a tight example? Secondly, is there any lower bound for the general case of the smooth complexity of local max cut in arbitrary case, or there is an argument for a polynomial time? Also, what about more complex local problems like max 3 sat, for example, which we were looking right now? Finally, an interesting and important question is how someone can transfer this machinery to other problems that have been analyzed under the framework of smooth analysis, like the new problems in the machine learning, for example. Thank you for watching, and please don't hesitate to communicate with us for any possible questions.